All right, everyone, I think it's time to go ahead and get started. So here's your official welcome to this BFC talk on this cold, cold first day of March, or at least it's cold in Moldova. I hope all of you that are in these cold areas are finding ways to stay warm. And those of you, if you happen to be in a warmer area, please, please, please send some warmth to the rest of us. We're looking forward and we're ready for spring. Before I present our talk today, I just wanted to remind everyone to check out the BFC Green website as well as the iShare Facebook group. They have different fun and useful information on staying healthy, staying active, and growing together as a community of people, as colleagues, and as friends. And also, I just wanted to let you know to be on the lookout for some new and exciting podcast content that's going to be coming soon from the BFC Green team. We're really excited for it, so I hope that you'll be on the lookout for those. Today, we are fortunate enough to be joined by BFC's very own Matthew Marek, who will be giving us a short introduction to digital filmmaking. For those of you who aren't lucky enough to have worked with Matthew yet, he brings a creative eye and a sharp mind to all the varied tasks he does at BFC. And more importantly, for this talk today, he has previous experience in filmmaking. Perhaps even more importantly, though, Matthew is just a very warm and genuine person. So if you haven't had a chance to work with him, I hope you get the chance soon. With that, I'd like to go ahead and turn things over to Matthew. So, Matthew, please go ahead and begin whenever you're ready.
Well, many thanks, Brian, for your very warm introduction and a good afternoon to everyone. Today, I'll be providing a brief overview of things to consider when embarking upon a digital filmmaking project. I'll touch upon a few different areas, including audio, editing, and equipment. But I would like to begin with a useful technique that is easy to overlook in non-professional productions: storyboarding. So, storyboarding is a set of images that loosely depicts the film we want to create. They can be rough or detailed, hand-drawn or pieced together from photographs. Every film should go through a storyboarding phase. This will help in establishing the shots which you will need and hence define your shooting schedule. A storyboard also helps to question assumptions and hones the story. However, you don't have to stick to a storyboard when you're actually filming. Sometimes that just isn't possible, or it doesn't suit the style of film you're making. In fact, it doesn't matter if your storyboard doesn't end up looking like your finished product at all. A lot of its value lies in its ability to set direction. Fits brings us nicely to the idea of scope. Scope refers to the ambitions and scale of the film. Questions like how many people will be interviewed? How many locations will be used? Will there be special effects? The most common mistake is to attempt to make a film with a scope that is far too large. If you try to do too much, you risk losing your key message or diminishing the quality of output. You even see this with films with very large budgets. Think of unrealistic computer graphics or lackluster action scenes. The best thing to do when defining the scope of your movie is to focus on the key goal of the film. Identify what is essential to that and ruthlessly prioritize it, cutting anything that is non-essential and building it back up. In short, be ambitious with your message, not in your scope. But of course, even for films with realistic scopes, you have to plan well. When making a film, details matter a lot. Before filming, think through the logistics of your shoot, from transport to food to setup time, anything that will happen on a day. A good schedule will keep you on track while filming, help to coordinate your team members, and enable a good quality film. But remember to also build in buffer time for your filming sessions, allowing flexibility for reshoots or delays. But of course, this has to be offset against efficiency. To achieve this, try to plan your time so the atmosphere is busy but not hectic. Good planning actually provides you the flexibility you need to get high quality results. But what equipment do you need to keep your film high quality? Well, first off, it should be said that your film can be shot on an iPhone and still be pretty good, but the task will be much harder and the image and sound quality much reduced. Luckily, there are countless good cameras out there, and the best option for you will depend on your individual filming needs and budget. But one additional piece of equipment I would strongly recommend is a tripod. These are great additions to any filmmaking kit, even if you're using an iPhone. A tripod allows you much more control over your camera positioning and ensures that the image is steady, making it easier for viewers to watch and enjoy. Another thing to bear in mind is that the camera's built-in microphone will probably not be particularly good quality, so seriously consider investing in a high-quality external microphone to improve your film's audio. Now would be a good time to also consider the role of sound in a film. This is, again, often overlooked. Audio is just as important to the overall quality of the film as visuals. More so in many cases. The most important aspect to consider is clarity of sound. You want it to be free of distractions. While filming, actively listen to the sound you're recording with high quality headphones. Listen for wind noise, unwanted background sounds, interference, feedback, cable rustling, anything that's detract from the clarity of the sound being recorded. If you do hear something you don't want, then don't hesitate to film a scene again, even if that means restarting an interview question. Bad sound can easily render footage completely useless, so be vigilant in making sure you don't accidentally record some. Now, another consideration that's important to getting good sound is the location you pick to film. When deciding on where to film, carefully consider the background for possible distractions and hazards. For example, there could be loud noises, running water, large crowds, or high levels of movement. For many scenarios, such as interviews for instance, a less interesting background can actually be a good thing, as it focuses the viewer's attention on the subject of the film. And you might recognize that island in the bottom right-hand corner from the latest Star Wars movie. This is, of course, a very exotic location, but probably beyond the scope of most films we'd be likely to make. So getting the location right is important, especially as a problem that arises from a bad location can't be fixed in the editing process. But it's the last thing I'd like to touch on today. Editing is where your film will come to life. You have full control. Use it. Don't be afraid to cut anything unnecessary. If it doesn't contribute to the story, or it takes away from the engagement of the audience, then it shouldn't be there. A quick note as well is I would recommend not to fret too much about the length of your film. As a rule of thumb, shorter is better, but engagement is a real key. An audience will watch a longer video if it holds their attention. Of course, there are natural limits to this, but bear in mind that engagement is really what you should be going for when crafting your story together in the editing process. Editing is a wonderful opportunity to get creative, so I encourage everyone to experiment in this aspect of the filmmaking process. To summarize, storyboard your friends, limit your scope, invest in a tripod, plan ahead, listen for good sound, and take joy in editing. It's really that simple. Okay, thank you very much for your attention, and I look forward to moving on to the discussion aspect of the presentation.